We are live on YouTube, ma'am. Ma'am, I'm sharing basically the intro screen so that we'll start there. And I hope the rest of the participants and panelists will be joining with a couple of minutes. Sir, now we are live on YouTube. I will be sharing link within a minute. So if you, it is better to join there in Zoom. Rather, if anyone wish to see it at YouTube, they can see it. I am sharing in the group so that you can check it yourself. मैंने ग्रुप में शेयर किया सर हमारा जो 14th में ग्रुप है.
Dr. Praveen has joined.
I was trying, Dr. Praveen. He will be joining. Morning, I had talk with Praveen, sir. Pratiksha, ma'am, already joined, no? Yeah. Okay. Shall we start? Praveen, sir, will be joining by that time, or should I wait for him?
Madam?
What do you say?
I think we should start.
Okay. So good evening, respected doctors, honorable moderator, and all the panelists here. Me, Nitya Gopal, on behalf of BrioBliss, welcome you all on this webinar session. Yes, the pandemic, the second wave is going on, and we are confined at home. So we have tried to utilize the time. So you know the time is not at all good. Many of the people are affected there, our near and dear one. So, but still, the life should go on. Yes, today's topic that we have got the current concepts in diagnosis and management of attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. So we have got today the moderator with us, the renowned child psychiatrist, Professor Dr. Preet Arun, and
Thank you.
Yeah, so we have got our moderator, Professor Dr. Preeti Arun. Dr. Preeti Arun is professor and head of the Department of Psychiatry, in charge of Child Guidance Clinic, Joint Director, Government Rehabilitation Institute of Intellectual Disabilities, and President Umeed Society, President Samarth Jio, President Paribartan. And she is associated with Government Medical College, Chandigarh. So we are proud to get a moderator like Dr. Professor Preeti Arun. So I would like to request Dr. Preeti Arun to take the dais and yes, to start your session, ma'am.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for BioBliss to organize this session. Attention deficit hyperactivity disorder is a disorder which is very common. It is a very common neurodevelopmental disorders, and there are many facets that we are always keen to know. So today's panel discussion on current concepts in diagnosis and management, it is a very timely session that has been kept by BioBliss. So in this, we have three wonderful panelists. And our first panelist is Dr. Devashish Panigrahi. So can I have his introduction slide, please? Dr. Devashish is consultant pediatric neurologist, and he has vast experience in pediatric neurological disorders, and ADHD being one of the neurodevelopmental disorders. It is one of his area which he's really passionate about. He is working with Jagannath Hospital, Bhubaneswar. He is ex-executive body member from East Zone for Association of Child Neurologists India. He has been actively involved in academics and training programs at national level, and he has several publications in index journals. So with all this background, we are sure that we are looking forward to a very fruitful session. So now I request Dr. Panigrahi to talk about clinical features and diagnosis.
You are muted, sir. Sir, please unmute yourself.
I sincerely thank Madam for her kind introduction and agreeing to be the chairperson or moderator for this session. I'll thank other panelists, Dr. Praveen Kumar and Pratiksha, to agree to become a panelist in this discussion today. And last but not the least, BioBliss for organizing the CME. So not wasting any time, I will start sharing my screen. Nitya, you have to allow me to share this screen. They host a disabled participant sharing. Can you see my screen?
It is there, sir. Make it full screen, sir.
Thank you so much. So I hope the screen is visible to all of you. So yep, today we'll be Today we'll be discussing on attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. And Madam has already told this is one of the most common childhood neurodevelopmental disorder, and it's quite common, prevalent in our society also. And if you start pick these children early and start intervention early, then you can make a difference in the life of the children and their families. With this background, we'll start our discussion. I welcome all the awesome audience there and thank you for joining in this CME. So our agenda of discussion today will be definition, followed by symptomatology or clinical picture, then DSM-5 criteria that is commonly used for diagnosis of ADHD. Then many times we are confused whether a child has ADHD or ASD. So we'll look at some of the difference between the two. Then a bird's eye view on management and something on neuronutrient and diet also in this condition. So starting with a case scenario. So a mother comes with her 7 year or 9 year old boys. The mother tells she is worn out, mentioned that her sons have always kept her busy. The younger brother has lot of trouble with his schoolwork. The mother said he is smart, but he is not paying attention to anything, cannot concentrate for more than few minutes on his homework, easily distractible, and never does what he is told. He is constantly misplacing his thing, even forget to brush his teeth or sometimes take his shower if he is not reminded time and again. The older brother is 9 year. He is also having trouble in his schoolwork. He just can't seem to sit still. At home, he is always fidgety at the dinner table while doing his homework. And he was called several times to school because he leaves his seat and sometimes in the classroom. He talks constantly, jumping from one topic to another and does not wait for his turn to answer. And he's constantly butting into conversation or disturbing others. So what do you think? What may be the likely diagnosis? Well, this can be a attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. We'll come to this case again once we discuss the clinical symptom. So I want to highlight one point here that ADHD, contrary to many people's belief, many parents believe that this is just a behavioral problem. The child is naughty, not listening to them, or he's doing it deliberately. But it's not just a behavioral disorder, but it's a neurodevelopmental disorder with an organic basis or a neurobiological basis to it. So research and studies have shown that this is basically in ADHD, there is a defect in your frontal prefrontal cortex and this subcortical connection like your basal ganglia limbic system and your reticular activating system. And genetic studies have shown that there is a disbalance in the neurotransmitter, mostly dopamine and norepinephrine has been implicated in the pathogenesis of attention deficit hyperactive disorder. So what is the importance of this point is that since it's an organic basis to this disease and it's a neurodevelopment, it's a neurobiological basis to this condition. Therefore, the treatment has to be targeted in the same way. Now, coming to definition, attention deficit hyperactive disorder is a neurodevelopmental disorder characterized by symptoms of inattention and impulsivity along with hyperactivity. So this is my favorite concept. These are the key concepts, the dimensionability and variability. What does that mean? That like features of ADHD or any behavior like your hyperactivity or impulsivity exists on a continuum along every person that can be placed like just like height, weight, and IQ. Similarly, a five kilo child, a weight of 18, he can be 18 kilo or he can be 15 kilo also, but both are normal. Similarly, behavior also exists, different type of behavior exists in different type with all the children. Some are little bit naughty, some are little more hyperactive, some are little bit hyperactive. So this falls in a continuum along the spectrum. So when a diagnosis of ADHD is made, we see that when these children fall in the extreme end of the spectrum, then only we can make a diagnosis of ADHD in this kid. So it is important to be certain that the symptoms are excessive for the child's age and it is associated with significant impairment. Again, another thing is variability. Variability can occur across the spectrum in children, also in the same child. What does that mean? It means that two children may not be same. Some child can be hyperactive, some child can be inattentive, some features can be seen in child, another feature can be seen in another child. So the children differ in ADHD, different children differ, have different manifestations, and in the same child also at different setting, the features can be different. At home, many times parents tell the mera bachcha to ghar mein theek baithta hai, ya bahar jata tabhi he does not, you cannot control them, or the symptoms are more seen in a different setting. So this is so variability is a rule in case of ADHD, not an exception. Now coming to prevalence, it is one of the most common behavioral disorder and exists in 3 to 5% of school age children, more common in boys with a ratio of 2.5:1 and 5:1 in different studies. This may be because the behavior associated with ADHD can be more characteristic and natural in boys than they are in girls. And when girls are diagnosed with ADHD, most commonly they have inattentive type of ADHD rather than the hyperactive impulsive type. Now, some studies from India, there are reported prevalence in different studies. One study from South India published in 2013 has shown 11.3% children to have attention deficit disorder. And another study, a Mumbai-based retrospective data study, has shown a 32.4% children of the school-going age had attention deficit disorder. So when you come, so when the mother comes, as I have already shown a case, the mother comes with this type of problem or this type of manifestation, then you want to evaluate whether the child has ADHD or not. So the evaluation mainly consists of identifying the core system, then assessing the impairment, identifying the possible underlying or alternative causes, then identifying the comorbidity. Identification of comorbidity is as important as identifying the core symptom, because that needs to be identified and treated also. So assessment can be based on rating scales, that can be based on interview from parent and teacher, provide very good information about the diagnosis that can help you to make good information about the child that can help you to make a diagnosis and plan your treatment. Then you can go for a semi-structured or structured interview basing on your different rating scales available. And interviews help to clarify object behavior and detect the alternative and the comorbid diagnosis. Observation provide further information about the behavior and the parent-child interaction. So the evaluation must include an interview of the parent as well as the observing the child in the office setup, and if possible, even its natural setup also, that can give you more clear idea about the behavior, why it occurs, what are the antecedents of the behavior, what is the behavior, and what per consequence this behavior are occurring. So that can give you a better idea about the behavior and help you to plan it. Therapy and everything better. So coming to diagnosis part, the diagnosis is usually made by DSM-5 criteria. The DSM-5 criteria came in 2013, and after that it is most commonly used. So what are the common symptoms described here? Are symptoms of inattention and symptom of hyperactivity and impulsivity. Hyperactivity and impulsivity usually comes together, and symptom of inattention comes in a different heading. So what are the main features of inattention in a child? Is failure to provide close attention to detail and making careless mistake in school, classes, and home. Difficulty in maintaining attention in play, school, and home activities, always getting distracted. Seems not to listen even when directly addressed. He will be looking here and there, and you will keep on talking to him. He will not give you a response. You have to tell him many times to get a response from him. Fails to follow through. If you ask them to do a simple homework also, some children, it will need constant reminding him many times to do his work. Otherwise, he will just go from one place to other and not complete his tasks. Difficulty in organizing tasks, activities, and belonging. Avoid tasks that require consistent mental effort, like a prolonged work or a homework. They are very difficult for this kid to do. Loss objects required for tasks or activities like school books, sports equipment, etc. Then easily distracted by the irrelevant stimuli, and forgetfulness in the routine activities like homework, etc. So these are the 9 symptoms of inattention described in the DSM-5 criteria. And coming to the symptoms of hyperactivity and impulsivity, they are excessive fidgetiness, always moving in the seat, tapping the hands or the feet. Difficulty in remaining seated when sitting is required, like school, in a class, when all the other children will be sitting at one place, you will be moving around in the class. Feeling of restlessness in adolescent, as the age increases, the hyperactivity and impulsivity generally decreases. So in that place, instead of moving, the child will feel very restless and very awkward in difficult scenarios where it is required to sit for a prolonged period of time. Along with that, inappropriate running around, climbing in preschool children can be seen. Difficulty in playing quietly, making a lot of noises. Difficulty to keep up with and seemingly to always be on the go, always running here and there. Excessive talking. Difficulty in waiting for his turn. Difficulty in waiting in a queue. Then giving answer too quickly whenever he is not asked also. If you only give answer after raising your hand, and when the teacher asks you to tell the answer, but he will not listen to you and he will give answer even if he is not directly asked. And interruption and intruding others. These are very common. These are the symptoms of impulsivity and hyperactivity in ADHD. Now for diagnosis, at least for to call it as a hyperactive or impulsive type, you at least require 6 six features for out of the nine features. And for inattentive also, you required six out of these nine features. And these symptoms must be present over a period of 6 months. The symptom must appear before the age of 12 years of age. And the symptom must be present in two or more settings, like your school, home, work. That's why I was telling you variability is the thing. So one setting, the child may not show all the features. So if you observe him in different setting, you can get more better idea about his behavior or your clinical feature. That must be clear evidence that these features are interfering with his performance in life, like his academic performance in the school, his social performance, like going to a party, a birthday party, or going to some friend's home, or playing with peers in a environment. So this behavior, if it starts affecting and creating problem for this child, then only we make a diagnosis of attention deficit hyperactive disorder. And the symptoms should not be explained by any other psychiatric disorder, like your mood disorder or a conduct disorder or personality disorder. So these are the criteria, and this criteria must be used for making a diagnosis of ADHD. Again, we'll come to this. So we have seen what are the criteria. Now, again, we'll examine this case. The mother looks for this first one is just for the 7-year-old child. The mother looks worn out and mentions that her sons are always kept her busy. The younger brother has a lot of trouble with his schoolwork. Number one, he is not paying attention, cannot concentrate for few minutes, easily distractible, and never does what he is told. He is constantly missing things and even forget his normal household activities. So it seems that he has a lot of symptoms of inattention. So the first child or the 7-year-old kid is most likely having a ADHD, which is an inattentive type. Whereas the older brother, he just can't seem to sit at one place. He is always fidgety and while in dining table or in his school work. And he does not sit in the classroom, always moves here and there, talks constantly, jumping from one topic to other, does not wait for his turn, and constantly increasing into conversation. So this child may have a hyperactive impulsive type or maybe a combined type of attention deficit hyperactive disorder. In both the cases, you can see there are a lot of symptoms. So you can either tell it's a hyperactive impulsive or an inattentive type. So these are the three types I have already mentioned about it. Now, the DSM-5 also tells you can segregate into mild, moderate, and severe type of ADHD. Mild one is where the symptom result only minor functional impairment. Moderate is when it is between mild and severe. And severe one is where there is a marked impairment of social and occupational functioning. So this is mostly depends upon your clinical judgment and your interview, that how much this child is facing difficulty in his day-to-day life in different scenarios. Then only you can divide it into mild, moderate, and severe. So what are the major changes that has come in DSM-5 compared to DSM-4? So this has conceptualized the criteria for more applicable to the adults. So one of the major differences is that unlike children, adolescent and adults are more than equal to 17 years of age. Instead of 6 criteria, we required only 5 criteria from each of the group to make a diagnosis. And initially in DSM-4, it was 7. This symptom must be present below 7 years of age. But in DSM-5, it has increased to 12 years of age. The subtypes are only current presentation. The severity and the subtype, both are current presentation. They may not be fixed. Because as I have already told you, as age increases, the hyperactivity and impulsivity decreases. And in adolescent or adult, it is mostly an inattentive type. So once a child who is told a hyperactive impulsive type in an early age or a combined type in an early age may later be diagnosed as an inattentive type of ADHD. And allowed for the first time, the dual diagnosis of ADHD and certain comorbid condition is there. The DSM-5 did not allow a dual diagnosis of ADHD with ASD, but DSM-4 did not allow. But DSM-5, we can make a dual diagnosis of ADHD along with ASD or ADHD along with oppositional deviant disorder or a conduct disorder like that. So these are the major difference between DSM-4 and DSM-5. So what are the common challenges in ADHD? Generally, the children have developmental delay like mild delay in language, motor, and social developmental delay. Due to this hyperactivity and inattentivity, they have impaired academic and work performance. They have difficulty in school. And as the age increases or as they move into a from a nursery to a class 1, class 2 and higher classes, their difficulties gradually increases and they find it difficult to cope with the other kids and the teacher and the increasing curriculum pressure with the increasing classes, poor occupational functioning, then cognitive deficit that can be seen in test of attention and executive function, memory may reveal cognitive problem. So the recent model tells that the ADHD is mostly a difficulty in executive functioning. So then there can be emotional impairment, low frustration tolerance, irritability, mood lability, and early adulthood, they can be associated with substance abuse, primarily with increased risk of suicide and all those things. So with this criteria, we can make a diagnosis of ADHD as early as 4 years of age. In preschooler also, you can use the same criteria. Less than 4 years of age, symptoms can be seen as early as 3 years of age or so, but making a definitive diagnosis become 4 years of age is difficult. So this can be diagnosed as early as 4 years of age and we can start the intervention. So there is a social impairment, as I have already told, it will be very difficult to take these children to parties, to other people's home. There's a lot of issues with the parents, they cannot take their child to other places and they gradually they face a lot of social issues. Then there is academic impairment, there is family impairment, lot of disruption in family structure and marital status of the parent. Then occupational impairment, like they are not get fit into the any type of occupation, problem with driving. So all these are impairment can be seen. Now ADHD is a chronic disorder that can seen across the lifespan. And contrary to the belief that many believe that boys of as age increases, ADHD will be decreased and the child will come out of a diagnosis, but that's not always true. 60 to 80% of children continue to meet the diagnostic criteria in the adolescent, and 50 to 70% children will continue to meet the diagnostic criteria even in the adulthood. But the symptom usually different, as I have already told, the hyperactivity, impulsivity decreases and more like inattention and more in the problem in the executive function will come when the child becomes bigger, higher and higher in age. So this is how this issues in life comes with ADHD children. In children, it is mostly academic limitation, then peer relationship, sometimes low self-esteem. Then coming to adolescent, they are more prone to injury, substance abuse, smoking, vehicle accident. Then they have, in adult, they have legal difficulties, occupational and vocational, then their marital relationship and all that difficulties they can face. So these are common, some of the common comorbidities that is associated with the ADHD, like your mood and anxiety disorder, autism spectrum disorder, substance abuse, emotional liability, learning disability, and tic disorder. So additionally, more severe the ADHD, more severe are the comorbidities. Now, commonly we confuse between ADHD and ASD. Many children, small children, 2 years, 3 years children come with diagnosis of ADHD to us. But there are certain features that are common between common behavior, certain features are common between ADHD and ASD. Like not playing well with the children, difficult to have conversation with others, hyperactivity and poor attention, poor awareness of danger. But the reason of this behavior is different in the two. The child, in case of ADHD, the child don't have interest. They don't reach out to others. They have poor social reciprocity, lack of interest in others. Therefore, they don't play with the peers. Whereas, in case of an ADHD child, he is too impulsive, hyperactive, does not follow the rules, and does not go by the rules of the game. Therefore, he has difficulty with his peers. So, difficulty to have conversation because in ASD they lack the skill and understanding of social norms and conversation, wherein in ADHD they lack listening, attention and too impulsive to wait for their turn to speak. Therefore, they cannot continue a good conversation. And in ASD they lack social participation but can focus well on own interest. Wherein in ADHD attention is mostly poor, though can improve its structure, praise and reward. And this poor awareness of danger in ASD is due to lack of understanding of social and physical risk, whereas they may know the risk, but they act before thinking. Therefore, they put themselves into constant danger. So one has to see that in ADHD, generally the children have interest, their social and communication skills are not that poor compared to ASD children. But in the ASD children, the core deficit is the verbal and non-verbal communication, the social interaction and the repetitive and restricted repetitive behavior. So one has to make the judgment accordingly. Now coming to the treatment part, a few slides on treatment. Though it's a chronic condition and need to be treated accordingly, educate the parent and patients about ADHD, develop a partnership with the family, develop a management plan with specific targeted goal, include the teachers and school if possible, and perform the ongoing monitoring and anticipate the developmental change. So these are the latest 2019 guidelines produced by the American Academy of Psychiatry. And one thing one has to understand that since it's an organic disorder, the first and the mainstay of treatment is medication. So there is a strong recommendation for using FDA-approved medication for ADHD. Along with this, teacher or parent-administered behavioral therapy. These two things are strong recommendation for treatment of ADHD. Probably both can be used for better benefit. And this medication, Dr. Praveen will go in detail with that. So I will just few slides. The clinicians should titrate the doses of medication ADHD to achieve the maximum benefit with minimal side effect. Stimulants are the first-line medication. Non-selective norepinephrine drop inhibitor like your atomoxetine are the second line. And maybe clonidine sometimes we use also. Then coming to behavioral therapy, this has also been shown to be effective. Sometimes the parents and family are too reluctant to start medication. In that case, your only option is your behavioral intervention. Generally, with behavioral intervention, residual symptoms of ADHD decrease after with the improvement of medication. If you combine with the behavioral treatment, the residual symptom will also decrease. Make pharmacological therapy more effective. Some studies have shown that this can increase the doses also, and the parent satisfaction is high. Whereas other forms of treatment like your mindfulness, cognitive training, diet modification or diet restriction, biofeedback, counseling, cannabinoid, all of this has been, some studies have shown some benefit, but there is insufficient evidence at present to recommend it as a part of treatment of ADHD. Now, there is a lot of buzz about neuronutrient in ADHD, and three main neuronutrients that we see in generally marketed now is omega-3 fatty acid, L-carnosine, and recently few companies have also come with phosphatidyl serine as a neuronutrient in ADHD. There are few studies which I could find on this role of all of this thing. And they have shown that this omega-3 fatty acid, this is a study, is a systematic review in role of omega-3 in psychosis, autism, and ADHD. And in ADHD, they have shown it has shown some benefit, but more better design studies are required. This is another article. For omega-3, the studies have shown that it can show benefit, but more better studies are required. This is for L-carnosine. This was a study published, this was a double-blind study, a randomized double-blind placebo-controlled clinical trial, and they have concluded that L-carnosine as a supplementary medication might be beneficial in treatment of ADHD, whether further investigation at different doses is required. This is another study regarding L-carnosine where they have used 800 milligram of L-carnosine per day for 8 weeks, and they have shown there are some benefit in impulsivity and hyperactivity in children with ADHD. So definitely it has got a role in management. This is coming to phosphatidyl serine. Phosphatidyl serine has significant research study published in 2017, where they have shown that phosphatidyl serine also improved ADHD syndrome and short-term auditory memory in children. PL supplements might be safe and natural nutritional strategy for improving mental performance in young children suffering from ADHD. So there are studies which have shown that this neuronutrient like your L-carnosine or this omega-3 fatty acid or phosphatidyl serine can be used as an adjunctive to this pharmacotherapy. And they have shown to improve the outcome also, and you can decrease the doses of your medication also if you use it along with them. So This is the role of this neuronutrient. Now coming to my last slide, this is about certification. Currently, Government of India does not include ADHD as a permanent disability. So unlike ASD, where you can get a disability certificate, in ADHD, disability certificate is not issued by Government of India at this time. Coming to the take home or summary, ADHD is a highly prevalent brain-based disorder which is associated with lifelong impairment and functioning. Environmental factors can contribute. Genetic studies and have shown that it is more common with the sibling of children with ADHD, with ADHD also with children whose parents have ADHD. So there is definitely some genetic basis, and gene related to dopamine and norepinephrine has been implicated. Environmental factor can also contribute to the expression of severity, course, and comorbid condition. Long-term development outcome of individual with ADHD can include substance abuse, chronic criminality, depression, and suicide. Therefore, it is very important to pick these children early and start both behavioral as well as pharmacologic intervention early so that you can get the best result out of them. If you don't treat them, they don't treat them or treat them late also, they can go into different type of problem when they become an adolescent or an adult. Stimulant medication and behavioral therapy are currently only established evidence-based treatment in ADHD. Combined behavioral and pharmacological treatment has the greatest impact on the functional outcome, and it is preferred by the parent and teacher, and most likely to result in improvement of the behavior. So these are the things that to look at in ADHD. I hope Dr. Praveen will cover more detail about this pharmacologic intervention, and Pratiksha madam will cover about this behavioral part of treatment in ADHD. So thank you for your patient listening and your attention. Thank you so much.
So thank you so much, Dr. Devashish, for the wonderful slides and such a scholarly presentation. Thank you so much. And I'm sure now everybody is looking to the question that how are we going to treat these children? Since we know that this is a very common disorder, so to talk on this topic, we have another wonderful speaker, Dr. Praveen Kumar, who's a child and adolescent psychiatrist, and he's working in Institute of Neurosciences, Kolkata. He has done his 2 years postdoctoral fellowship in child psychiatry. Since he has done his fellowship in child psychiatry, he is absolutely the right person to talk on this topic. He has been actively involved in research on developmental regression in children with autism, and he has presented papers at World ADHD Congress in Canada and ESCAP Congress at Vienna. He has received certificate training in pediatric bipolar disorders and pediatric psychopharmacology. So with this background, we are really looking forward to Dr. Praveen's talk on pharmacological management. So Dr. Praveen, please start with your talk.
Sir, you are here?
I can't see him there now. Was there?
1 minute. Sir was there.
Yeah, he was there. I see
some technical things could be there. Just 1 minute.
Maybe.
Sir has left. He was there, just some technical glitch could be there, and he's joining.
He was there just a moment back. I saw him.
Yeah, sir is here.
Yeah.
Sir, please unmute yourself.
So, Dr. Praveen, welcome.
I'm sorry, ma'am. There is some internet connection issue.
Yeah, that's perfectly fine. Please start with your presentation.
Yeah. Just
1 minute, sir. I think I have to make you co-host. I made you as you have left, so it has gone out. Just give me 1 minute.
But we can see his slides has already started sharing.
All right, sir, you start.
Yeah. Okay. Hello?
Yeah, you can go on, sir.
Okay, thank you. Today's topic is my topic will be basically on pharmacological management. As it was discussed, ADHD, it's a neurobehavioral disorder defined by persistent and maladaptive symptoms of hyperactivity and impulsivity and inattention. So if you can see that about 60 to 80% is of symptoms of ADHD persist into adulthood. So recently there was one conference, just like virtual conference last week only, it's on World ADHD Congress, where the topics of discussions were like ADHD in adults, ADHD in elderly. So now that's how ADHD is being discussed across the lifespan. So if we can see the prevalence, like there is a great variability in the prevalence. So like if you see the prevalence in USA, it's around 8.1%, and Iraq, if you see, it's 0.1%. So even there is a prevalence rate difference between European countries and UK and US. So people ask, like, there is a for the ADHD diagnosis. So what is the heritability of ADHD? It's a pool data says that heritability is 76%. That means it's one of the most common, like, heritable result in ADHD, like especially polymorphisms in dopaminergic genes, there are dopamine receptor genes which are responsible, and dopamine transporter gene. Polymorphism in these genes interact with the environmental factors. So basically, environmental factors are like there are three factors which have been consistently shown to be associated with ADHD. One is maternal smoking. Second is very low birth weight and premature delivery. So there is a significant association between, especially with very low birth weight. That means birth weight less than 1500 gram, significantly associated with ADHD in children. So it is the interaction of interaction between genetic factors and environmental factors. Also, like, there are some environmental factors which contribute to ADHD like symptoms in children, especially when there is a maternal depression, especially inconsistent parental discipline. Even ADHD, we sometimes say that as a secondary ADHD is seen in children following traumatic brain injury. ADHD like symptoms, even ADHD is more common in children, especially who are in foster care, in adopted babies. So definitely both genetic and environmental factors interact to result in ADHD symptom, but there is a strong heritable factors involved. Like the children with ADHD, we often ask also parents, is there any ADHD symptoms in parents? So like when it comes to treatment, ADHD is still unexplored disorder in India. So cultural factors are known to affect identification of psychiatric illness and management of problematic behaviors in children. So medical knowledge about the benefits of treating ADHD will hopefully reduce barriers to diagnosis in future. So when it comes to ADHD management, it's a holistic management of ADHD. That means, like, we are looking from short-term goals, long-term goals. So in short-term goals, it is first we have to manage the symptoms. And along with that, like, we have to work, whenever we talk about a child, we have to think intervention in terms of a child, family, and the school. So that's how the treatment revolves. So we have to work with, we have to treat symptoms of the child and also address basically, we have to educate the parents about, like, what is ADHD and what are the symptoms of ADHD and what are the challenges associated with ADHD. And also we have to liaison with the school regarding, like, what are the symptoms. We even like, as Dr. Devash said, like, we need to take information from multiple sources, as variability is a rule in ADHD. That means sometimes, so to call it ADHD, we need to see these symptoms should be impairing in more than two or more than two settings. That means, for example, if child is only having symptoms in one setting, for example, in the school setting, but it's not observed in the home or other setting, but if you see only symptoms in the home context, not observed in the other setting, then we need to think about whether that context or that situation itself is causing symptoms of ADHD. For example, a lot of time children with especially borderline IQ, low average functioning, even those with a learning disorder, sometimes when the demands go up above their developmental level, they start manifesting inattention. So we need to check, is it their demands are as per their developmental level. As I said, like sometimes family issues, maternal depression, chaotic family background sometimes results in lot of ODD and conduct symptoms. So we need to observe the symptoms in a two or more settings too, then we can confirm the ADHD diagnosis. So it is when it comes to management, we need to think about child, family, and the school. So a basic treatment plan should take an account like first ADHD as a chronic disorder, and it may consist of both psychopharmacological and or behavior therapy. So we need to always look into take family preferences as very in designing the plan for treatment. So as I said, like psychoeducation is the first cornerstone of the treatment, parental and also child psychoeducation. Even when for example when he's an adolescent, so you can educate about ADHD, you can give the basic concept about ADHD. So so what are ADHD and what are the so how it presents, so what are the treatment options they have, and so these are the basic and what are the common comorbidities they have, and what are some of the basic behavioral techniques. So we need to so first important is psychoeducation is important. So psychoeducation is different from psychosocial behavioral therapy. So psychoeducation is basically focusing on like giving the parents about basic concept of ADHD and developmental challenges and treatment options. So when it comes to the medications, like there are some medications which are FDA approved and some medications which are not FDA approved. So basically medications which are FDA approved are methylphenidate, amphetamine, dextroamphetamine, atomoxetine. These are FDA approved medications. And those medications which are not FDA approved, like tricyclic, we call it second line, tricyclic, so bupropion, clonidine, gonfacine, and other medications like modafinil and venlafaxine. So when we talk about treatment of ADHD, the mentioning about MTS study is very, very important, because the whole literature of ADHD treatment was started on based on this the big study, MTS study. So what basically they did was like it was a 14-month trial, clinical trial, initial study was, and they divided into four groups. One, children who are just only on medication, who are put on only stimulants, children who were put on only behavior treatment, third group, children who were put on medication management and behavior management, that is combined therapy, and fourth is community-based treatment. So community-based treatment was like not properly, it was just a community, it was managed in a community setting, not under an expert, this one. So so these were the four categories which were there in the MTA group. So when it came to results, like drug, they found that drug therapy was superior to behavioral therapy in managing ADHD symptoms. And combination of medication plus behavioral therapy did not have any additive effect. So behavioral therapy was useful, but the effect was not as robust as drug therapy. So behavioral therapy is useful for ADHD patients, especially with mild symptoms or minimal impairment. So in this graph, we can see that like the combination therapy is no more like additive compared to the just medication alone management. So what they found is compared to placebo, both medication management and medication plus behavioral therapy, definitely these children, they did very well compared to just behavioral treatment or community-based treatment. So what reviewers said is there is a definitely superiority of stimulant over the non-drug treatment, but no evidence of an additive benefit of combination therapy was found. So that was the one thing which was being discussed. So behavioral therapy may be recommended as an initial treatment when, if the patient ADHD symptoms are mild with minimal impairment, when the diagnosis of ADHD is uncertain, when parents reject medication treatment, or there is a marked disagreement about the diagnosis between parents and teachers. So for preschool ADHD, behavioral therapy is the first line treatment for the first 2 months. So these are the some indications for behavioral therapy. So when it comes to initial psychopharmacological management of ADHD, it should be with an agent which is FDA approved. So either you try with a stimulant like either methylphenidate or amphetamine and atomoxetine. But when it comes to stimulants and non-stimulants, so what research says is stimulants are highly efficacious in the treatment of ADHD. So 65 to 75% of subjects with ADHD have been determined to be clinically responders to stimulants compared to the 4 to 30% with the placebo. That means that's improvements in the most impairing symptoms of behavioral symptoms, decreased interrupting, visiting, improved parent-child interaction. So improve in a peer nomination ranking. So it not only just improves hyperactivity or inattention, it improves overall behavioral issues, even impulsivity, even some of the behavioral emotional components. So overall stimulants improve the most of the domains of the ADHD. So in stimulants now we have come, there are now there are forms, basically immediate release, sustained release and extended release. So maybe for a last few years, maybe now extended release is available in our country. Initially, like only immediate release and sustained release available. Immediate release formulation, they generally act for 2 to 3 hours, max 4 hours. And sustained release, sometimes it varies with the brand. So it might act for maybe from 6 to 8 hours. But the extended release, which has come into the market in India, so especially Oroz methylphenidate, which is called Concerta, one of the preparation, so which acts for a period of 12 hours in a day. So when it comes to, we assess the efficacy of any medication with its effect size. So effect size of stimulant is almost 1. That means it's the one of the largest effect of any psychotropic medication. That means you give stimulant, definitely there is a response. So that is the way so stimulants work. So among the both amphetamine and methylphenidate, the evidence suggests that 2 are equally efficacious. Either you can choose either of the 2 as a for a starting the treatment. So there are, as I said, like immediate releasing stimulants, they act for only 2 to 3 hours or 3 to 4 hours. So that's why whenever you are giving immediate preparation in Inspirol, you have to give 2 times or 3 times dosing is required to cover the throughout the day. Because typically, like when you give stimulant maybe in the morning, by the time children are in by 12 o'clock or 1 o'clock, its effect starts waning. So children starts getting symptoms, especially during the lunch time and all. So so to counteract that, now these days, as I said, long acting formulations have come. These act for a period of 8 to 12 hours, and they offer a greater convenience for patient and family. So one of the study which was done was, like, you can see the graph how Oroz methylphenidate, that's a long acting preparation, act. So generally it starts acting within an hour, and its effect lasts for 8 to 10 hours, whereas immediate releasing immediate preparation, they act for 2 to 4 hours. Within a 2 hour they peak, and their effect wanes off within another 2 hours. So every 4 hour we need to give medication. As I said, like it sometimes you need to give BD or TID dosing, which is required. So these are different. So the nowadays the technology nowadays is more on more drugs which can cover a period of 12 hours. But sometimes what we see in clinical practice is, despite giving sometimes long acting stimulant, sometimes, for example, if you give a long acting,
any issue, sir? Praveen, sir, any issue? You are muted. Hello.
Fine. I think I okay. Is it visible?
Full screen. Make it full screen. Yeah.
Is it visible?
Yeah. And now, okay, sir.
Okay. So a lot of new preparation come, like as I said, even the for long acting, sometimes if you give a long acting preparation at around like 7 to 8 a.m., sometimes it affects, goes off by 6 o'clock. Those children who are studying in the late hours, late evening hours, by maybe they, those who are studying in the 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock night, sometimes we need to give an short acting immediate preparation combining with a long acting stimulant. Maybe like we give, for example, we give a morning long acting preparation and the short acting preparation we give around 6 o'clock around to just cover the evening this one. So what is the dose at which we need to give? So because see the one main difference between in the MTS study where medication management and the community based difference was the dose was not given appropriate. So that's why a lot of failed trials are because of inadequate doses. So it is shown that the children with ADHD they respond better whenever they are given a proper dosage. That means they respond at a bit higher dosage. Second, they respond when you give a TID dose, especially if you are giving a immediate acting preparation. So, and when there is a monitoring, you need to monitor the child, like maybe after a month, after a, depending upon, ideally recommended is when you are starting the dosage, you need to monitor every week or 2 weeks. So that's not possible in our setting, but like at least we need to monitor initially for first few months, like 1 month, 2 months, you check the scale, like how he is performing on the ADHD scale, whatever the scale which is available in your area. So the dosage is very important. What is dosage which is recommended is children at the dosage of 1 mg per kg per day or max at the dose of 1.1 mg per kg per day, most of the children with ADHD, they respond. So that's why we need to give them. But especially what is the whenever we are giving dosage more than 60 mg per day of methylphenidate immediate preparation or more than 72 mg of Concerta, we need to be careful about the side effects. So like as Dr. Devash said, ADHD symptoms can be seen in preschool. So whether stimulants are effective in preschool children. So the studies have one, the good study was done, PAT study, which is preschool ADHD treatment study, which showed that methylphenidate is effective in preschoolers also. But the mean optimal dose is it's a 0.7 mg per kg per day, which is lower than the school age group, which is like what is the dose 1 mg per kg per day. But interestingly, one very important thing in preschoolers is those children with a significant developmental delay are prone to higher side effects, especially side effects in the form of social withdrawal, irritability, and crying. So you have to check, is it just ADHD or is there any comorbid ID, is there any comorbid ADHD is there? Whenever there is a comorbid intellectual disability or comorbid developmental delay, comorbid autism, so that means these children are not going to, they generally have side effects in the form of irritability, crankiness, and all. So we should be careful in this population. So is there any difference between stimulants and non-stimulants? So stimulants are the first class of compounds which are reported to be very effective. And if you see that response rate is 70% is if you try with first one stimulant, but once, if for example, methylphenidate is not effective, if you switch to the amphetamine, the response rate goes up to 80 to 90%. That means if you try two stimulants, the most of the children do respond. So, but when we give non-stimulants like atomoxetine, especially when we give, if methylphenidate has been tried and has been ineffective at the maximum dose, or a child is intolerant to low or moderate doses of methylphenidate, you go for atomoxetine. So atomoxetine, as you all know, that it's a noradrenergic reuptake inhibitor that is superior to when the trigger of ADHD. What is the effect size? It's twice daily with second dose given in the afternoon or evening time. So one important thing
please wait, I think. Sir is facing some issue with the net. Yeah, Preeti madam, I think by that time some questions are there. If you please address Praveen sir, I think will be joined, or you may take it as per your convenience.
I think the questions were one is specifically for Dr. Praveen, because he's the right person to answer that. The question from Chitrani Devi, and the question from Deep S. I think we should come to it a little later, because it's not right to go on back and forth between question and presentation. Yeah, we would just like to wait for a minute.
Thank you, pardon for the thing. Yeah, just let it get over.
Yeah, so Dr. Praveen is back. Yeah, please carry on with your presentation. And I think it's already almost 7:30. So, and we have some interesting questions which you would be the right person to answer. So,
yeah, I'm unable to show this PPT.
Yeah, 1 minute, sir. Yeah, now you can do it, sir. Is it coming, sir?
Hello?
Yeah, sir. Can you share it now?
Yeah. Okay. Is it coming?
Yeah.
Is it coming?
Fine, sir. It's perfect.
Okay, fine. Thank you. So, as I said, meta-analysis shows that atomoxetine effect size is 0.62 compared to methylphenidate immediate acting and long acting. So, it's clear that definitely methylphenidate is effective compared to the atomoxetine, but atomoxetine, whenever when child is not tolerating methylphenidate sometimes when there is a comorbidity like especially anxiety disorder, tic disorder, and sometimes even I see children coming with a comorbid seizure disorder where it becomes difficult to give methylphenidate. That is the indication where we try atomoxetine. Although clonidine is now as per FDA, it's a small to moderate effect size, but in our country we routinely give clonidine as a management for ADHD, although it's shows that it's more successful in treating hyperactivity and impulsive symptoms than in attention symptoms. So more it's recommended for treating tics and stimulant-induced insomnia rather than a primary treatment for ADHD. So these are the response rate, as we can see in the graph, both methylphenidate and there is a none of the above stimulants is effective when we treat ADHD. That means that is the time we need to think about, is there any comorbidity? Is there any undetected comorbid mood disorders, undetected anxiety disorder, or subtle developmental delay? So that's why we are not getting the response. So when there is no adequate response to the medication and child has comorbid ODD, conduct disorder, it is time to combine the psychosocial behavioral therapy with the ADHD. So whenever we give psychopharmacological management, we need to look for treatment emergent side effects. So especially we should be careful with respect to those with a pre-existent heart disease or a significant cardiac disease. So common side effects are appetite decrease, weight loss, insomnia, and headache. So common side effects can be just managed with reducing the dosage, or using medications melatonin can be used to just correct the sleep issues. If there is appetite issue, like you can use cyproheptadine to reduce the stimulant related anorexia. So guidelines which is being discussed, like the pharmacology is the there is a strong evidence for stimulant medication, and for adolescents, yes, it's same like both pharmacology and behavioral therapy, but we need to plan for at least 2-year management. So that is the thing. But CADRA guidelines, Canadian guidelines, which say that now in Canada they use more of a like oros methylphenidate, so Concerta, which is recommended as a first line in the CADRA guidelines. And with respect to NICE guidelines, it's even methylphenidate used in children with EDS with comorbid conduct disorder, even without comorbidity also. When it comes to tics, there is a even people say that like methylphenidate can still be safely used in children with tics without worsening. So like related starts the growth. So evidence says that yes, although there is a growth delay which is seen in initial first few years, but this effect like attenuates over the time. So, but still we need to monitor height and weight throughout the treatment. So, as I said, like the European guidelines, they recommend giving medication after meals, giving high calorie feeds, especially towards the evening, because the medication's effect goes off by the evening. So you compensate the appetite loss by giving more food in the evening. So they recommend. And people ask about drug holidays, whether we need to give drug holidays. Although the literature says that generally ADHD medication can be given throughout the week, but especially when there is a growth appetite suppression is there, like you can think about giving a drug holidays on the weekends, or like you can think about giving the drug holiday during the summer time, especially summer holidays you can think about. So how long we need to continue methylphenidate is a question, but what is the guideline says is that as long as it is effective and as long as symptoms are present. So every 1 year we need to assess, is there any ongoing need for a children with ADHD, because so that way it helps. So my last slides are like, although it's a very big topic, like treating comorbidity with ADHD itself is another topic. So I will be just touching, as I said, on the comorbid ADHD. So we need to be careful, because compared to the typical ADHD treatment, like methylphenidate, a magnitude of response is less in children with autism, and they show more of adverse effects. So they become more cranky, irritable. So before giving high treatment of ADHD medications for children with ADHD, we should be very careful, and we should educate the parents that we are giving a test dose. If child tolerates well, then we can go up on the this one. But children with ADHD generally, children with autism are given 1/3 of the dosage which is given for ADHD children. So that's why, so they tolerate very low dose of stimulants. So when there is a comorbid bipolar disorder, comorbid psychosis, you stabilize the primary psychiatric pathology, then you treat the ADHD. That is what the recommendation is. So you can wait for ADHD treatment until unless mood symptoms are stabilized. Then once the mood symptoms are stabilized with the anti-AED medications, then you can reassess, is there any need for a medication. But trials have shown that methylphenidate can still be given in a mood stabilized youth with comorbidity. So in a summary, as I said, like it's a most common neurobehavioral disorder. Stimulants are the remain the first choice of therapy. But whenever there is a comorbidity, we need to think about behavioral therapy. And whenever, especially in preschool children, we should go for behavioral therapy first, then pharmacological treatment later. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Praveen, for your very erudite presentation. It was a really wonderful talk.
Stop share, sir. Praveen, yeah, fine.
And so now we are on to the last presentation, which is again a very important topic, that is behavioral management. And behavioral management is important when, as it was told, that when the parents are not accepting pharmacological management.
Thank you so much.
And at times,
very erudite presentation. It was a really wonderful talk.
Just 1 minute, yes, sir. One minute.
And so now we are on to the last presentation.
Hello, ma'am. Please continue. Yeah.
Yeah, so I would invite Ms. Pratiksha Kar, who is MPhil in clinical psychology, and she's currently working as clinical psychologist in Child Developmental Center, Braintree. And she has good experience of fieldwork. So Ms. Pratiksha, please. And since it's already 7:38 and the session concludes at 8 p.m., so I would request you to please limit your presentation so that we leave about 10 minutes for question answers also. Thank you so much.
Yeah, Pratiksha ma'am, you can unmute and Pratiksha ma'am.
Yeah, so I've started screen sharing. I'm not sure if I'm able to do it, if everybody can do it. Is it visible?
Yeah, visible. Make it full screen.
I'll be talking about the... Oh, yeah, sorry. I'll be talking about behavioral management in ADHD. In my subsequent slides, I'll be looking at the main aspects to address in ADHD, the impact ADHD has on the child's surrounding, like family and marital functioning, prevalent parenting styles in ADHD, what behavioral therapy is, duration of behavioral intervention, impact of behavioral therapy on child's life, focus area of managing ADHD across age groups, components of behavioral therapy, then psychoeducation, parents' role, parent training and techniques are all part of components, then self-concept in ADHD and CBT. I'll just touch upon these topics. And finally, I'll conclude with challenges to therapy in ADHD. Previous speakers have talked about the core symptoms of ADHD and how it impacts various aspects of a child's life. And from a therapeutic point of view, we always look at the various the domains under which the child is being affected. So in classroom participation, the child may have difficulty with following teacher's instructions or not being able to follow the rules of the class, or even sustaining at a particular task that he's required to, or being seated for the required amount of time. He may also have difficulty in managing peer relations. For example, talking over others, not being patient enough to listen to others, not being compliant or cooperative with them. Then there could also be other behavioral problems of stubbornness or defiance. These are some of the interpersonal problems that the child may have. There's also intrapersonal problems like managing emotions. He may react too quickly, have anger outbursts, or have inappropriate laughter. Some other goals which are not the primary focus of any child who comes to the presentation of ADHD include higher order skills like negotiation, conflict resolution, and self-confidence, self-esteem. These are often addressed as therapy continues and as the child progresses in his age. So far we looked at how the child's functioning is addressed in therapy. It is also important to address the child's surrounding, which includes his family, so his parents' marital functioning as well as the family. They may experience conflict with among themselves regarding dealing with the child's problem. They may also experience added burden as opposed to a typically developing child, or they may have to continuously monitor him during his academic tasks or his even his activities of daily living. They may have a reduced quality of life. They may socialize less due to fear of embarrassment that their hyperactive or impulsive kid may bring to them. So usually it is found that the family has that they function less cohesively in the family. So parenting styles, typically most research suggests that there's no typical parenting style that is associated with ADHD. However, certain factors do have been well established, such as inconsistent discipline, a low involvement of the parents, more commanding, less rewarding style, punitive parenting, Then there are certain other researchers who have also found authoritarian parenting style and permissive parenting style to be significantly associated with the ADHD. However, such researchers are not, such research has not been too extensive. Authoritarian parenting style usually includes low warmth and harsh punishments, and permissive parenting style includes less structure, less rules, and more affection. What is behavior therapy? Behavior therapy aims to modify behaviors, that is, increase desirable behaviors and decrease undesirable behaviors based on the principles of operant conditioning through various stages to improve functioning of an individual. So behavior therapy looks at two kinds of behaviors, ones that are problematic and that need to be reduced, and others that need to be increased. So the skills that the child does not have yet, and they are done through principles of operant conditioning, that is, using reinforcements and punishments, and the primary goal is to improve functioning of the particular individual. Duration of behavioral interventions, often it is long-term, although it varies across children. And initially it is more intensive, that is, the child may need to come for the therapy every day of the week or so. And gradually it becomes more intermittent. And with different targets of the therapy over different age groups, it varies. Impact of behavior therapy on child's life. So there is behavior therapy essentially strengthens the parents' coping mechanisms and teaches children strategies to overcome their undesirable behaviors. For example, a parent may not know what to do when the child is throwing tantrums. So behavior therapy teaches them to not be overwhelmed and actually equip them to deal with their child's behavior. Second is increased participation. So through behavior therapy, parents are able to participate in their child's life better, and they're able to understand their child better. Then children are also provided with various skills that they can use whenever they identify what behaviors are causing them problems, and then they use their skills to overcome those behaviors. And eventually there's an improved communication between the parents and children. So focus area of ADHD across age groups. Usually in preschool, it is more to do with controlling their high activity levels. They are not able to sit through any activity. They're constantly moving from one place to another, and they're constantly switching between activities, and they do not wait for permission of another person. They're constantly maybe snatching things. In school age, it becomes more to do with managing their academic difficulties, like completing their homework, listening to the teacher, keeping up with the classroom activities, or sitting quietly when they're required to do so. Family interactions are also looked at. For example, kids with ADHD mostly are reprimanded most often. So it becomes important to address that during this age and improve the communication between the parent and parents and the child. Then peer relationships are also addressed for children with school age. Time management skills, organizational skills, coping with distractibility, and social skills training. Adults, it is not exclusively behavior therapy, but therapy focuses on self-esteem, building their self-esteem, prioritizing their work, engaging in health behaviors, such as not getting inclined towards excessive substance use, and maintaining harmonious relationships, being able to solve problems without becoming too overwhelmed. So these are components of behavior therapy. So the first thing is psychoeducation. Before we start with the therapy itself, we first psychoeducate the parents about the problem their child is going through. Then identifying reinforcement skills and problems to assess to be used and addressed in therapy. Setting targets based on the previous assessments done. Engaging parents, that is telling them their role in the therapy and getting them fully involved in the process of therapy. Applying techniques applying techniques of behavior therapy, then monitoring progress after having applied the techniques, re-evaluation of those techniques based on the progress that we see, and modifying those techniques as required, and further continuing monitoring. So psychoeducation is extremely important because it provides a clear understanding of the disorder to the parent. Parent may just assume it to be, just assume that the child is not willing to do such and such things, but they may not actually know that he's not able to do these things. It is also important to describe to them how ADHD manifests, how ADHD is manifesting in their child, the causes that are behind it, and what we can expect in the future for the child, and the available treatment options. So this is particularly important because it increases motivation for therapy. Parents will be more, when they can make sense of why they're doing it, they'll be better involved with the therapy, and it becomes more efficient because now that they understand what is going on, it becomes easier to communicate with them. Then it creates an empathy within parents. Usually parents are very frustrated with their kid with ADHD, but after psychoeducation, we can expect some empathy within the parents. Also, if we do not provide psychoeducation and parents do not understand why their child is acting so, there could be continued flawed parenting that further aggravates the situation. Further in the therapy process, after providing psychoeducation, we identify the strengths and weakness of the child. So to do that, we use a clinical interview and certain scales to measure severity. The ones with higher rating, we include them in the problem behavior. Then parents report, teachers report of his functioning in various domains, and direct observation also helps. Parents' role in their child's therapy. So parents are required to be involved in the therapy right from the start. So they need to know that they cannot completely depend on the therapist to manage the symptoms, because the child is with the therapist only for a limited period of time, but that they need to manage the child as he's acting naturally in their environment. So therefore, they need to come for regular feedback and follow-up so that the therapist also has a clear idea of how the child is functioning outside of the therapy setup. They are also required to go through parent training. So they also have to take the effort of actually attending those 10 to 20 sessions, either individually or in groups. Then there is also whatever task the therapist is doing in the sessions, or however the therapist is approaching certain tasks in the session, the parents also need to practice that at home. For example, the child has difficulty in doing his homework, so the therapist uses a certain approach to do it at the therapy setup. The parents also need to use the same approach at home, and they need to practice it over and over. They also need to apply structure and techniques at home that they learn in their parent training. Parents are always there when with the child, or almost always there with the child. So they will only be able to generalize these skills across settings. So they need to apply the same techniques and structures across settings. Parent counseling is also important for stress management and emotional well-being of the parents, so that they're able to cope up with the keep up with the therapy sessions, as well as cope up with the child's behavior. And most importantly, they need to remain patient, and they need to know that it takes time and practice to go through the process of therapy. Parent training are of different kinds, and it's usually weekly sessions spreading over 10 to 20 weeks. And parents usually identify the antecedents, whatever is causing the problem behavior, and that's and further react to it. One second. Then they learn strategies to adjust those antecedents. So behavior is occurring and there are many factors that may be causing the behavior. So what happens right before the behavior is happening, they need to identify it and they need to modify it in order to prevent that behavior from occurring repeatedly. Then enforcing consequences through the use of reinforcements or punishments. Then observing and improving parent-child interaction. That is, in the parent training session, the facilitator usually observes the child interaction with the parent and then identifies what is wrong with it and provides feedback to the parent and therefore improves that interaction. They usually do it by in either through role play or by watching videos as well.
Pratiksha, yeah. I'm so sorry to be interrupting your wonderful presentation. You have 2 minutes more, please.
Okay, so I don't have too many slides, I just have 5 more slides now. So techniques of behavior therapy, behavior diary is one such, behavior diary is usually kept or keep track of why the behavior is occurring. So by keeping this diary, we are able to identify why a certain behavior is taking place. We note down the antecedent, that is what happened right before the behavior, and the consequence, what is happening right after the behavior, and that's why that's how we are able to sort of find the purpose behind the behavior. Then accordingly we modify the antecedents and the consequences. So if a child is throwing tantrums and he's doing so exactly during homework, and give him a timeout, that is not going to work because that is what he's looking for. He's looking for an escape during that moment. So instead, while he's doing that homework, while he's throwing tantrums, we need to maybe give him full prompt, like full physical prompt, and hold his hand and make him do his homework while ignoring his tantrums, but not letting him escape through that process. So if we identify such consequences, we will be able to identify the purpose, we'll be able to plan our consequences better, and eventually without the consequence, that behavior is going to become extinct. Then reinforcements, there are 2 kinds of reinforcements, positive and negative, and we provide reinforcements to increase the likelihood of any behavior. While providing reinforcements, we need to make sure that we start with something very concrete like an edible or a tangible, and then we move to token economy. So if a child is if a child did something desirable and so you provide him with a reward that of his liking. So you can't generalize it. Something that he likes, and you have to give him immediately, and he should not find access to it at any other time. Then punishments as well. Usually punishments are not recommended. Usually given as a form of negative punishment, such as taking away TV privileges. So we have to give them clear instructions and rules that if you don't do this, then if you engage in such negative behaviors, then your TV privileges or your other leisure activities will be taken away. Then we need to focus on the positives of the behavior of the child. For example, children are especially with ADHD, they are not paid attention until they're actually engaging in problematic behaviors or creating or are engaged in disruptive behaviors. So we need to actually focus on the positive, however small it is. We actually need to emphasize on it, because whatever you emphasize on grows on the child, and that's how you'll engage in it more and more. Then there is planned ignoring. So there is ignoring when a child is throwing too much tantrum for, let's say, a particular tangible, and we are not providing him. So instead of addressing why are you crying, or you know try to understand, so instead of doing that repeatedly, we are providing him some kind of an attention. Rather, what we need to do is just ignore the child when he's throwing tantrums and pay more attention when he's engaged in productive behaviors. Like I previously mentioned, the reinforce needs to be, or the punishments, whatever we are applying, they need to be immediate and exclusive to that situation. Also prompt feeding. So a lot of parents find it very difficult to engage their child in doing their homework. So instead, they're constantly sitting there, they're giving them multiple instructions, they're giving them verbal instructions, like do it, or they're actually doing it themselves as well. So what we need to do instead is we need to fade those instructions and maybe like tap on their notebook, or give them a small reminder So we need to fade the prompts and wean them off getting, so they're too used to these repetitive instructions, and we need to wean that off. And whatever we are telling the child, it has to be very clear and it has to be direct. And then the rules need to be laid out clearly. And you know, in token economy as well, whatever, if you tell them that you're going to get 6 stars, and if you get 6 stars, you can watch TV. So for watching TV, he needs to have 6 stars. Then it also needs to be consistent. So if you're applying the same things for 1 week and on the 8th day, you're not doing it, so the child will now continue his tantrums or problematic behavior. Still, now he knows that if I don't do it, then on the 8th day, I'll get it. So it has to be consistent. The practice needs to be very consistent for it to actually work. Then providing alternative behaviors to the under. So for example, if a child is reacting too quickly or becomes too angry too quickly, so we will not tell them to not be angry. That's like, often we tell children to not do something, but we don't tell them what to do instead. So we need to tell them to not do something and provide alternate behaviors for it. So, you know, when you're angry, being angry is fine, because then you're validating the emotions. Being angry is fine, but then you should not be shouting when you're angry, or that you can't be hitting when you're angry. You can do other things, like maybe hitting the cushion, or you know, expressing your anger in a proper way, that I am angry because you did this. Similarly, timeout is another such technique that needs to be done for only 5 to 10 minutes when the child is throwing, or when the child is creating problem in the environment, and we need to remove him from that reinforcing environment. And then after 8 minutes or so, bring him, and it needs to be done immediately. Modeling is again very important. If the parents are aggressive, if there's a lot of aggression going on in the environment, the child is going to imbibe that and he's going to learn that. So modeling such behaviors is very important around the ADHD child. And whenever we are trying something, we need to understand that the child is different from the typically developing children. So if we want him to do, you know, homeworks today, we can't expect him to do all 5 subjects in 1 day. So we'll just start with maybe 1 page. If that is too much, we can just start with 1 letter or 1 line. And it needs to be as small as that. And we need to start with small and then gradually increase the baseline. So these are some other tools that we use.
Pratiksha, we are already, it's already 8 p.m. Pratiksha.
Okay.
Your presentation is really wonderful, and it would have been really lovely to have it in full detail, but I'm afraid we have already reached the time limit.
Yeah, I understand. So I'll just stop it here then.
Okay, no.
Also, I would like to say that when there are other presentations going on, and you know, when others are sort of not being, because they are presenting, they're obviously not too mindful of the time. So maybe intermittent reminders would be helpful for future members.
Absolutely right, Pratiksha. So there are certain questions in chat box. So one question is that, can we put a preschooler on some therapy? That was there. I'm not able to get the question now. So we usually do not start pharmacotherapy before 5 years of age. So it will not be started. So Dr. Parveen, there's one question for you. That is that, how's the interaction of the drugs in case of CLHIV or ALHIV who are on immune suppressants and antiviral drugs, and the best time to take the medication?
So ma'am, can you please repeat, ma'am? I could not get the question.
It's in the chat box.
It's in the chat box, ma'am.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Have you got it, sir?
No.
Okay, I'll read it again for you.
All right.
Have you got it, ma'am?
This one. Yeah. Okay. How is the interaction of the drugs in case of CLHIV, ALHIV, who are on immune suppressants and antiviral drugs, and the best time to take the medication? So I believe the best time to take the medication must be for medication for ADHD. So that you have already covered, Dr. Praveen. So maybe you can answer this.
I think
immune maybe suppressant, antiviral drugs.
Yeah. Okay. I think, like, as far as ADHD and like interaction concerned, maybe whenever there is too much of medical comorbidity, we need to just look for whether a bit of non-stimulants in such cases. But until unless something which is very interfering with respect to cardiac issue, or until unless something very interfering, whether any other medications have seizure propensity capacity, seizure lowering tendency, then in such cases we need to avoid stimulants, and we can give like atmoxetine in such cases. But I think ADHD treatment, ADHD medications do not have significant drug to drug interaction with other antivirals, or that's what I feel.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you so much. So there's one question that if ADHD is identified at a later stage in adulthood, suppose at the age of 30 or later, then what can be the best way to treat or to get help?
Yeah, it is like more like an adult ADHD. So like treatment guidelines for adult ADHD, it is more or less now same, like methylphenidate is effective in adult ADHD also. But like adult ADHD is like a very fancy diagnosis, so we need to be very careful before making adult ADHD diagnosis, because comorbid illness look like ADHD, but they are not ADHD. So once we have to have ADRS scale, that's a scale called adult ADHD rating scale. We can do such scales to just confirm the diagnosis. Then like when we have decided that yes, it's an ADHD, stimulants can be given. There is a lot of evidence for stimulants, methylphenidate in adult ADHD, but dosage we need to keep in mind. Dosage is like we need to give as per body weight. Like it might be sometimes they are weighting around 60 to 80 kg. In that case, in adults up to max, like in Western countries, they give up to 100 mg per day methylphenidate. So we need to think about the dosing. But yes, methylphenidate and atomoxetine both are effective in adult ADHD.
Thank you so much. But another point in this answer to this question is that there could be many behavioral interventions which can be done.
Definitely. Definitely.
So Pratiksha, maybe if you can highlight that something for adult ADHD. Pratiksha, you are there?
Pratiksha, ma'am, you are here?
No, I think I can't see.
Network issue could be there.
Yeah. So for adults, they are able to identify their own issues, and it's mainly because of the executive functions that they experience issues in their daily life or managing things. So they can be taught many skills with which they are able to benefit it. So that is for adult ADHD. And then another question is that in case of comorbid depression with ADHD, which should be addressed first, ADHD or depression?
Yeah, so that's a very interesting question. Maybe you are also, your experience also would definitely help in that answering that question. So I feel, ma'am, like more of it is we have to treat depression. Like as I said, like whenever there is a primary illness, primary psychiatric illness, we need to treat primary psychiatric illness, be it bipolar, be it depression, be it psychosis. Then we need to assess for ADHD after 6 months. That is what like I follow. Like maybe I wait for 3 to 6 months, treat depression, and then treat ADHD. Having said that, sometimes adolescents present with both symptoms. They have from the childhood, they have some ADHD symptom, and now adolescents, they are developing a depression. So that's what like sometimes first thing is like we need to treat depression, and along with that, like once you treat the depression, after that also your attention issues are persisting, academic issues are child is struggling with the inattention, academic decline is happening despite proper trial treatment with ADHD despite proper treatment of depression, in that case we need to go for a addition of stimulants or atomoxetine.
Thank you so much. So basically depression would take precedence, and a case of depression, when they are usually searching on the website, they find some checklist for ADHD, adult ADHD. Absolutely. And they go through that, and then they diagnose themselves as adult ADHD. Yes. There are many people who have come to me after diagnosis themselves as adult ADHD. But then Absolutely. It's not adult ADHD, it's inattention because of their depression. So that becomes the primary thing to treat. And yes, very well said, Dr. Praveen, that we need to treat it first and then go to the next one. So, yeah.
Praveen, one question. Do you ask for this cardiac monitoring before starting in all children with stimulant or ECG or something, or we can start it like that? Hello?
We in our center usually ask for ECG. And actually, at times, people may think that if we are asking for ECG, parents would be really worried that why are they asking for ECG? It's a very dangerous drug. But that is not so. Parents actually feel good that, yes, we are taking all due precautions.
Yeah.
And regarding this...
That's what... that's a recommendation.
So all children, you ask for an ECG before starting of stimulant.
In most children, yeah.
And what your experience about duration of treatment with stimulant? Suppose you started in a 6-year, 7-year-old child. Generally, how long you continue on this? Or how to plan to stop? What is this? How do you plan it to stop after some time?
So, Dr. Praveen, would you like to answer that? You already answered part of it in your presentation we have to give it for as long as it is beneficial.
Sir, I could not listen, sir. Some connectivity.
How long you are when you start in a 6-year, 7-year-old child, how long you continue with this methylphenidate or stimulant?
Yeah.
And when you decide to stop it, what is the decision to make to stop it?
Yeah, that's a very, very good question. And it's a completely a clinical decision. Like generally, sometimes after that, like with 2 years, and some is the medication. So children, like when they came, like support to stop the medication completely a few months, 2 to 3 months. Like I asked them to just stop the medication, and once they start schooling again, they can start medication. But generally, like some children, we give up to like it's like class 12. What I do is like those children.
I think he dropped out.
No problem.
So basically, we do continue the medication, and what I explain to the parents is that when the child will understand, when he grows up and he realizes the need for the self-control, his executive functions are working better, and with the behavior therapy inputs and everything, he will be able to better control his behavior. Till then, we continue with the medication. And it's a clinical decision when and how to stop the medication. Yeah, so I think... I've already overshot the time.
I just lost touch, contact, ma'am. Yeah.
Yeah, so Dr. Praveen is back. Yeah, hello. Yeah, Praveen. Yeah, your connection
so,
is shaking.
Sometimes, as I said, like, hello, ma'am. We give sometimes up to class 12, like what I, those actually adolescents, I give up to class 10 stop medication. That is what I use, because up to class 10, somehow they need attention, like for improvement of attention, academic issues and all. So especially when you start medication in the 10, so literally they up to...
No, I think his connection is really shaky.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Madam, any role of risperidone in ADHD. Many people prescribe along with methylphenidate. I've seen people prescribe at night dose of low dose of risperidone. So is there any role of in pure ADHD who don't have ASD? Maybe with ASD.
So actually, as per US FDA, there's not much role. But in clinical practice, low dose means one ml of any substance has 20 drops. So 1 milligram per ml, maybe 1 or 2 drops are usually can be given. But not like 0.5 milligram or 1 milligram, not like that. But in really low doses, in some cases, it is helpful because it also works on impulsive behavior and aggressive behavior. So that gets taken care of. And there it works very well, which is a really a big problem in children with ADHD.
That's true, madam. In ASD, actually, it's difficult to give medication sometimes.
Yeah.
But in ADHD,
so, Dr. Praveen, would you like to answer about use of carnosine? You are muted.
Praveen, sir, if you are having a problem,
you can switch your video off.
Your voice will come better. Yeah, you can.
Okay, thank you. Am I audible?
Yeah.
Okay. Carnosine, there are a lot of open label studies which shows that carnosine is effective, but although there are no very good randomized RCTs or meta analysis which shows that it is effective, but yes, omega 3 fatty acid carnosine definitely in open label studies they have shown to be effective in improving the cognition, specific also improving the attention, but as of now we do not have any recommendation as such.
So I would complete that on behalf of Dr. Praveen, and that is that we do give it as add-on, and though there are no clear-cut studies and guidelines, so that is what
it is. Yes, ma'am. Yes.
It all can have benefit, but you need more controlled trials to say that.
In our department, we had planned one MD thesis on this topic, but then unfortunately lockdown happened and clinics were, we were not able to do that. Yeah. So I think we had a wonderful interaction and a very fruitful discussion and very good session. So I would deeply thank you, Dr. Debashish, Dr. Praveen, and Ms. Pratiksha. So for your and all the audience for your wonderful participation. So management before 5 years is primarily behavioral therapy. That is what it is.
Thank you, ma'am.
So thank
you. Right. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, the respected doctors, the participants, and moderator and panelists there. Once again, thank you very much for attending this session. So we'll be coming all these sorts of programs quite frequently and obviously informing you. Thank you all. Good night, everyone.
Thank you. Good night. Mm-hmm.